outside of noticing the lump, I had some problems retaining information. I was under a depression, and you know, that was not like me. I never had depression before. Aloha, my name is Melissa Adams. On my mom's side, we're Hawaiian. And in 2017, I was diagnosed with invasive lobular carcinoma, and I live in Oahu, Hawaii. I was on the tail end of my master's degree, and so I was deep into my grad work. And one day I looked up in the mirror after taking a shower, and I noticed that one of my breasts weren't normal looking. There was a weird look to it. I had insurance through school. I was about to graduate. So I was really concerned. I didn't want to be diagnosed because I didn't want to have this pre-existing condition and not be able to get treated with my new insurance. When I saw the nurse finally at Kapi'olani Hospital Women's Center, she assured me, she's like, no, we got to get this checked out. This is serious. So all in one day, I had an ultrasound, a mammogram, a biopsy, and then a week later, the Friday before Mother's Day, I was diagnosed with invasive lobular carcinoma. I was so concerned with grad school and just finishing and nervous about all that. It didn't hit me. They say ignorance is bliss, right? It didn't hit me until after the surgery. My stage was invasive lobular 3C. Then I had to go get a second opinion. And since we live in Hawaii, it's very hard for us here. That was a major obstacle for me because at that time, the second opinion was after my operation. I still had drains in, so I couldn't lift anything over my head. My boyfriend had to take time off of work. We have to fly to the mainland. That was a huge burden financially, time-wise, also physically. And then after, I had 18 rounds of chemo, and then I did about 28 rounds of radiation. I kind of knew that it was only a short amount of time while I'd become metastatic. So I had hormone therapy all the way up until I got diagnosed with stage 4. Challenges and barriers that I faced during treatment, I would say it was tiredness. The mental hit that I took, also the emotional toll it took on me. And also I have what they call chemo brain. So it's hard for me to retain information, and that's been a real big hit. And I feel so guilty about that. And also just living in fear too, because you know, stage 4, so it's now a point of, you know, like how much we can keep the cancer at bay. Right before my surgery and after my surgery, we discussed clinical trials, but a lot of them were on the mainland. You have to like fly over, get a hotel. You have to take time off of work. And for those that are still working, it's just impossible. People live paycheck to paycheck here, a lot of us do.
The one thing that struck me about cancer disparities, so I got the opportunity to go to a breast cancer conference. And I got to kind of rub elbows with researchers and oncologists that were there. And I looked at their data and I noticed that they grouped Pacific Islanders and Asians together. And that does a disservice to everyone in that group. To put that data all clumped together kind of muddles the numbers.
How am I doing now? I am doing great now, honestly. Even though I have the diagnosis, even though I have progression, my attitude toward cancer has shifted. I do feel a lot more fulfilled, especially when it comes to the patient advocate work that I do. As far as treatment goes, I'll be on treatment for the rest of my life. When it comes to cancer funding and research, there's not a person on this earth that doesn't know anybody that has cancer. We need to start somewhere, and funding's where it starts.
If I could give any advice to somebody going through this,
there's a lot of amazing research and medicine coming in the future, so don't count yourself out.